I've graduated out of Welcome Group Graduate School of Hotel Administration, which is in Manipal University, Karnataka. And currently, I'm with the Bombay Canteen, which is a modern Indian restaurant in Bombay. But because of the pandemic, I'm kind of like in a furlough situation. And because of that, I'm running a very simple cloud home kitchen, if that's even the right word.
I won't call myself a chef since I'm still learning. But yeah, I mean, entered the food industry. So like it's been around 3 years I've been working here. And yeah, I mean, I was supposed to be in Bangkok till May. But I mean, interning in a restaurant called Ga. But because of this pandemic, I had to return back to India. So I was just figuring out what to do in the meantime. So just out of nowhere, I just kept a post like in case if anybody responds, like, you know, if anybody wants to try any food of mine. So I just kept it on Instagram, got some response. So that's how like it's been 3 months after starting that.
One thing I observed almost everywhere I went is the underrepresentation of Indian cuisine and especially South Indian cuisine.
A lot of stuff that the South Indian restaurant, the Nadodi, was doing, like, well, pretty much like puttu. I mean, but he's taking that to a whole new level. Like, normally puttu, I'm sure you might be knowing the coconut rice steam, but no, he presents it in a beautiful way. And like, in the best part, the biryani, they serve biryani in a fine dining restaurant, but that was the best biryani I had till now. Like, it was amazing. No, alanti biryani na ippadu daaka tinaledu basically. So, like, they're bringing a lot of local stuff as well. Like, you know, since they're in Malaysia, so they bring a lot of Malaysian elements as well into their cuisine.
So in the food industry, generally, manam em observe chestam ante, there's a lot of ఏమంటారు ప్రెవలెన్స్ గివెన్ టు సస్టైనబిలిటీ అయినా లేదా ఇప్పుడు ఆర్గానిక్ ఫుడ్ అని వస్తుంది, అది కాకుండా దేర్ ఆల్సో వీగన్ డైట్స్, న్యూట్రిషన్, యూనో పీపుల్ ఆర్ చాలా కాన్షియస్ అబౌట్ న్యూట్రిషన్ గురించి. సో ఇవన్నీ లైక్ వాట్ ఆర్ యువర్ థాట్స్ ఆన్ దీస్?
సో ఐ థింక్ టు కైండ్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ క్వశ్చన్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ ఓవర్లాప్స్ వాట్ తేజ వాస్ ట్రైయింగ్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ ఓవర్ ఇండియన్ ఫుడ్ అవుట్ సైడ్ ఇండియా. You know, because the representation of food of India is just only so much. I think one of the reasons this movement in India, along with underrepresentation of Indian food in the West, is because Indians itself haven't, haven't kind of dug out and given traditional recipes and kind of given it that limelight. I was saying that something as simple as a Nagaland pork curry cooked in this fermented bamboo paste, I guess, but it's called akuni, and it's been around for years. Like, it's very, very traditional, and it's coming into limelight only now. When people go out and kind of set up their restaurants, or even traditionally have been, their outlook also is so limited to show to the world, because one, maybe they're not taking that much pride in the traditional culture. That is definitely one of the reasons. And two, there is not enough documentation of historic Indian food traditions. You know, even if it is, it's not come out that much. You know, like Indian mithai, for that matter, is so underexplored. I don't know how to put it into proper words, but because you don't have set recipes to make this kind of mithai. Like, you go to the West, you'll find proper recipes on how to make a croissant, how to make donuts or cruffins or this and that. There's so many trends
about like that. Indian mithai, because you mentioned it. I was very startled. One of my European friends asked me, so you guys eat sweets in India? I didn't know Indians have Indian sweets. I just thought it was all chili. I was so disappointed. Like, ikkada manam local kuchune, we know all kinds of sweets and cuisines that we guys can make, and why there is no documentation or no presence out of it? And part of it, yes, it's mostly even us, we're not so connected or proud of our traditional cuisine. Yeah, even we run behind donuts and stuff like that.
I think that's only now, over the last, say, 15 years. But even, say, something like a butter chicken is only as old as, I would say, 1950, like 1960. It's very recent. There are cuisines like, okay, take example of palak paneer. Initially, it started off as a accumulation of different leafy vegetables called saag. Like, you know, sarson ka saag is a popular dish that comes in the winter. But initially, it used to be a practice of just collecting different winter leaves, and they would make a saag. And making paneer also is not an Indian culture. Like, it is not at all a traditional thing to do in India. Like, you think about it, Indians have always valued milk. Like, even in Hindu culture, milk is such a holy thing. Imagine splitting it and making paneer out of it. Can you ever think about it? It's not something that originated in India, and the British actually taught us how to do these things. Like, I would very simply also say that tandoori chicken would not come to India if the British had not showed us how to make roast chicken, or had even shown roast chicken. So a lot of the Indian food we eat today is so influenced by the British, and because of that, like, over 200-250 years of their ruling has just overpowered all of that traditional culture and food practices and dishes. So many things have just either been lost or haven't come up to the surface.
In the context of, again, culinary arts or cooking or chefs, how do you think ippudunna the cooking industry or the restaurants or the people itself, how do you think they're acting or they're contributing to kind of connecting back to our traditional roots?
I would say, take example of the phase, like this whole fad of turmeric latte. You know, like, turmeric is such a common household measure to just, you know, get your illness away or just improving your health and things like that. It's become such a fad in the West. And drumstick, we've been eating drumsticks as kids for years now, and some like it, some don't. But in the West, drumstick is such a fad. Like, drumstick, somewhere I had seen drumstick milkshake or drumstick smoothie, like a whey protein kind of drink. And, you know, it sounds weird to us, but a lot of Indian age-old practices are just like yoga, are fads in the West, and then they come back to us, like, in this reversed form. I think veganism is, to be very frank, not a very natural thing when it comes to, you know, humans and stuff. We're always meant to have certain things in our diet, but I think because of, obviously, you know, agriculture methods are changing, this world is changing, and this, that, obviously it's affected us. And over the decades, there are people who can't tolerate lactose, and so people turn vegan. Also that, and the whole fact that, you know, animals are reared in such harsh conditions over the world for, you know, poultry and fishing, and it just becomes difficult for someone to continue that kind of diet. They just want to switch, but in consequence, your body is not adapted to that immediate switch. Like, you can't just substitute milk from your diet, or you can't just substitute, I would say, like, if substituting milk, you just can't have soya milk all the time. You can't just have paneer all the time. And I would simply say that in India, veganism is still got that tag of you can only do it if you're privileged enough, because, yeah, a common guy can't really switch their diet choice if they want to, because they just don't have that ability to. You know, you get what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, I mean, almond mingo soy milk is twice as expensive as
a, exactly
in a pre-COVID, in a post-COVID era, post-lockdown era, especially as someone who's not on the cooking side, I would think restaurant anedi will like turn down its human interactions and it would be more robotic, for the lack of a better word, by bringing in more robots to just chop stuff and all. We also see videos of machines doing it. So for you as people in that industry, be it hospitality or cooking industry, what is the future of these industries for you?
No, it's quite too early to talk about, you know, having robots, but definitely some point they will enter. Now, we have, as humans, have been adapting to different technologies. Now, so in case robots are China, like, there will, you know, maybe some more opportunities as a chefs, or, you know, like, we still find a way as humans to figure out, you know, get some work, not necessarily in the, I mean, robots are China, even like, internet, it was completely different situation, but internet, humans have adapted. No, same with AI, same with technology. We, China, like, we'll still figure out something.
I believe it's kind of like a cyclical thing. Like, just to give an example, like, before the Industrial Revolution, everything was more relied on labor and handmade handicrafts. And, you know, even bread was artisanal. Now it's coming back like that. So over the decades, machines already did come over. And they made life easier. But you can see the trend of artisanal food is coming back. So I would say if robots are going to replace human work, I would say it's already happening for decades now. And we've taken advantage of it. Like, instead of needing 30 kilos of dough for certain bread, machines are doing it. And we're actually getting more output out of it. So I would say robots will not replace chefs or even hospitality professionals. It'll only aid the whole process. I'm sure to a certain extent the need for staff will reduce and things like that, but there's only so much robots can do.
Now, tell you now, what's the difference between culinary and hospitality? Like, how different are those?
So hospitality industry and encompasses everything. There is culinary, there is front office, there is service, there is housekeeping, and then there is obviously other departments, you know, which any organization will have. But culinary is only kitchen. Kitchen can again be pastry or, you know, hot kitchen, as they popularly say, hot kitchen, cold kitchen, like very traditionally people will say
right,
that.
Okay.
When I finished my 12th, I was still kind of little confused because I was not entirely sure if this is for me. And I think a lot of people who come from the hospitality background initially have always had that self-doubt, you know, because the hospitality industry for a lot of people, it's a industry that only people who don't study well go to. To be very frank, cracking an entrance test to one of these institutes, any institute for that matter, is not that difficult. You know, if you have a couple of days or maybe a week's prep, anyone can crack it, because one of the things about this industry is a low entry barrier. Anyone can join. You don't need to be Einstein to be hospitable. Initially, I was more really inclined to pastry and bakery. I felt it's easier. I mean, I know many pastry chefs will kill me for saying pastry is easy, because pastry is not an art at all. It's completely a science. A lot of chefs will tell you that. Because essentially, at the end of the day, you're dealing with chemicals. You're having a leavener, which is a chemical. You're having fat, you're having sugar, you know, protein, and all of those things really just require you to know a fair amount of food science. You know, what is doing what.
So I heard about this theory or this example that most of the top chefs start their careers by peeling potatoes or something. Is that
yeah
kind of an indication that cooking anadi or working in kitchens anadi is very hierarchical, that you have to start from the very bottom, like work your way up and all that.
So that's always been the case. So like I mean, pretty much everyone like always start as a dishwasher or as a commie, like commie ante the first entry level and matter. So normally akkada nunchi like they start slowly, you know, oka level. There are a lot of levels and matter, commie 1, 2, 3, malli demi chef an untadi, then the CDP an untadi, then sous chef, then like there are a lot of hierarchies, but you know, it's for the betterment of the restaurant itself. You know, as a chef, it's very important to work under different chefs. You know, like stage, like as Ratish mentioned, like stage and they're like working for free. So they don't, you basically pay for you. You just go on your terms. You just ask them like, I want to work for free. You just go like work for a couple of months or weeks, and like, just to learn how he's preparing his dishes. And Malaysia lo like I interned at a place called Narodi. Alani, I went to Malaysia, like worked for a few weeks there. And then after my course finished, I was planning a lot to go in Bangkok to work there in a one-star restaurant, one Michelin star ga. So I mean, I wasn't expecting akkada dorukutadi endukante, like, you know, getting into such a big place, usually everyone interning there is pretty much sous chef or head chef level. I mean, like it was really lucky that I was able to get an opportunity to work there.
So meeru, yes, after you're done, so during the last few months COVID unnapudu, meeru mee own home kitchen start chesi, you've started selling all different kinds of food, that too during COVID, especially endukante ఫుడ్ సేఫ్ గా డెలివర్ చేయాలి, హైజీనిక్ గా ఉండాలి. సో ఇవన్నీ ఎలా మేనేజ్ చేస్తున్నారు?
ద మేజర్ కన్సర్న్, నో మ్యాటర్ వాట్, ఫుడ్ హస్ బీయింగ్ డెలివర్డ్, లైక్ ప్రాపర్ గా డెలివర్ కన్సర్న్ అనేది అందరికి ఉంది. సో మీన్ ఇట్ వాజ్ హలీమ్ సీజన్ ఐ గెస్, సో మీన్ బయట హలీమ్స్ దొరకట్లే, సో దాట్ వాజ్ మై పాయింట్ వేర్ ఐ స్టార్టెడ్ యాక్చువల్లీ. సో లైక్ మోస్ట్ ఆఫ్ మై బెస్ట్ సెలర్స్ వర్ లైక్ ఇట్ వాజంట్ ఇన్ మై మెన్యూ అట్ ఆల్. సో ఎవరైనా అడగాలి, ఐ మీన్ అప్పుడే నేను చేస్తుండే, దాట్ యూస్ టు స్ప్రెడ్ అలాంగ్. నార్మలీ నా మెన్యూలో లైక్ ఐ జస్ట్ ట్రై టు ఎక్స్పెరిమెంట్ స్టఫ్. ఐ మీన్ దెర్ ఆర్ సమ్ రెగ్యులర్స్ యాజ్ వెల్, బట్ నో లైక్ సిన్స్ ఐ హ్యావ్ డిఫరెంట్ ఎక్స్పీరియన్సెస్ ఓవర్ ది పాస్ట్ ఫ్యూ ఇయర్స్, సో ఐ జస్ట్ ట్రైంగ్ టు పుట్ అవుట్ జస్ట్ టు అండర్స్టాండ్ లైక్ హౌ పీపుల్ ఆర్, ఐ మీన్ ఆర్ దే అవేర్ ఆఫ్ సచ్ స్టఫ్, ఆర్ లైక్ ఆర్ దే ఓపెన్ టు నో ట్రైంగ్ న్యూ ఫుడ్. So atlani, like I have been developing the menu and things have been going pretty well for now.
What about you, Ratish? Nikal onto
what incidentally happened was Zomato and Swiggy was banned in Hyderabad for quite some time. Initially when the lockdown was there, I think it was banned for about 1.5 months, and I was in a state of thought that, you know, if people were more open to a home cook delivering food which is probably just as good as a restaurant made food, would they be open to it? So I was still very doubtful. So I put out a survey and I ran it for a month and got a lot of responses, and I made it quite detailed, and I even asked them what they would want to have, you know, very very detailed. But to a large extent, I am doing purchasing on my own. I am doing some amount of delivery on my own. Delivery to far off distances is still, I still depend on, you know, Swiggy Genie or Uber or Dunzo. And I'm always open to people picking it up, which is a great advantage. People are more open to coming and picking it up than having it delivered via Dunzo, because it reduces contact, right? And I think working backwards, planning, and really just following my routine has helped me.
So, Rohit, from okay, first time Halim try chesi to now, like 2-3 months tarvata, you started jackfruit tart ani leda corn husk tea ani and stuff like that. So, how did the transition of 2-3 months into finding a space in home kitchens work?
And Atlanta, like Haleem undi, like that's like a main seller, but there was also a side menu. It's actually my main menu. So like people used to also have a look on that menu as well. So Haleem iskunto, like they used to order some of the stuff from my menu, which was a bit different. So like Atlani, you know, I used to get a good response from the menu. So like Ala like started continuing to add more stuff, you know. Like I wanted to include seasonalities as well. So that was the main motto behind starting this. So like prati season, you know, I wasn't aware of there were a lot of seasonal fruits itself in Hyderabad. Like I had no clue at all.
Yeah.
Like, revolving around different places, you know, appudu I started learning, you know, essentially seasonalities enti asalu ev eppudu ostayi, like what's the whole role behind, you know, produce having seasons and how to work with them, you know. That's one of the biggest challenge, in fact. Endukante 1 month oka produce ostayi, like you have to prepare a dish out of that and sell it for just that month. So that's the biggest challenge. Like it keeps on changing, you always get different produce. So in fact, like I'm the only person in the kitchen, so so preparing the regular stuff, doing a test kitchen and doing marketing and all that, you know, like it's quite tough, I would say.
So when you guys are speaking about food or hospitality or culinary arts, this one thing that strikes me is, as someone who's studied in lecture based classes, which is just engineering or math or physics or something, it's hard to ardham avatle how courses at hotel management or culinary arts work. Would you also have theory and practical? Or
ippudu nen ellina institute, for example, like it's like majority is practical stuff. So I mean, they don't teach you all the stuff that restaurants are doing. Like restaurant stuff is authentic for them, but they just give you a gist, like, you know, this cuisine has this basic stuff. So I mean, for example, sauces and soups, and they just teach us the basic stuff. The whole course is about learning the basics of every cuisine, but ultimately when you go into the real world, it's not just that, you know. They, you know, chefs experiment, you prepare new dishes. So atla, you know, the industries evolve. So in a institute kelna, like you just learn the basic theory and basic practicals, that's all.
So how it would work for us is, you would have different classes, and some of these classes would parallelly talk about what was happening, like in the sense that if you're talking about a cuisine, there was a little bit of theory and at the same time there was a little bit of practical. If you're talking about basics, which, you know, we keep talking about in this this particular context, basics means a basic understanding of a cuisine, basic understanding of like, you know, what sauce requires what processes, what temperature, what time. Basic, again, when we keep saying it, also means, say, cooking temperature of, not just when it comes to baking something, also cooking temperature of different meats, different vegetables. It can also be an egg, you know. I remember the first class we had was just egg. We had different methods. We learned to boil an egg. Like, who doesn't know how to boil an egg? But to my surprise, there were three different or many more different types of boiled egg at different temperatures and different times. So then we went on to learning how to poach an egg, and that is the practicality of it. But then when we came to theory, we were also talking about, okay, an egg has the yolk has these things, then the whole structure of the egg, at what temperature does the white set, what temperature does the yolk set, what are the characteristics of an egg, you know. There's so much that we had to know in theory, which was indispensable before going into practical.
I was just saying, I think it was important to understand that even each vegetable has a certain temperature and time, because as someone who cooks for myself and eats, టైం లేకపోవడంతో ఐ పుట్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఆన్ హై ఫ్లేమ్ కట్ ఇట్ త్రో ఇట్ ఆన్ టు ద డిష్ అండ్ దెన్ ఈట్ వాట్ ఎవర్ బట్ వన్స్ ఐ అండర్స్టూడ్ ఓ మీడియం ఫ్లేమ్ అంటే ఇట్లా ఉంటుంది హై ఫ్లేమ్ లో చేస్తే ఇట్లా ఉంటుంది అండ్ ఆల్ ఇట్ ఐ థింక్ ఇట్ ఓపెన్స్ అ హోల్ న్యూ వరల్డ్ ఆఫ్ హౌ ఈచ్ వెజిటబుల్ టేస్ట్ డిఫర్స్ ఆర్ సంథింగ్ How hotel management is much more diverse and people mistake it for cooking. So, explain me what are the different, I wouldn't so much say career options because that's again the end result, but what are the different things you learn in the course?
So, I mean, at the very base of it, at the most elementary level, there are four operational sections in hospitality. There's the kitchen, there is service, which I don't think most people understand, but service involves a general waiter's job or even a bartender's job, so that comes under service. And then there is housekeeping, and then there's front office. When you get into these four departments much deeper, there's so much more. Like if I talk about service, someone will think, okay, I don't want to be a waiter. All right, don't be a waiter, but you can also look at bartending. There's also this deep understanding and the whole section of alcoholic beverages. There's wines, there's beer, there's gin, and people make a career of just drinking and alcohol.
If people would like to follow you or your work, where should they go? What should they check out?
Check me on Instagram, it's just Rohit underscore Chidurala, or can follow my home kitchen page, that's Rosh Kitchen. I even have Facebook, just Rosh Kitchen on Facebook.
Yeah, it's about the same. I have an Instagram handle which I've maintained for a couple of years now, and it goes by the name Ratish97. I put out some interesting dishes occasionally, and usually if someone orders from me, they kind of get that idea of checking out my handle, and so most of my stuff is out there.